Hi, everybody. This is Peter Schiff. It is Friday, November 18th, 2011. It's been some time since I recorded my last video blog. I have been pretty busy, been traveling a lot, actually just finished up my book that's coming out next spring. But for those of you who want more frequent updates, remember, I do the Peter Schiff Show every weekday from 10 a.m. to noon on schiffradio.com. So you can either listen live or go to shiftradio.com whenever you want. You can listen to the show delayed or sign up to be a premium member and listen to the show commercial free at your leisure. Anyway, a lot has been going on since my last update. A couple of things though that I wanted to talk about today. Number one is there is a lot of discussion and a lot of pressure being put on the ECB to follow in the Fed's quantitative easing footsteps. A lot of people on both sides of the Atlantic think that the ECB should alleviate the sovereign debt crisis by just printing all the money they need to buy up all the Italian bonds or the French bonds or the Greek bonds that investors don't want to hold, and that would put an end to the crisis. Now, I think that's wrong. I think, first of all, to claim that the Fed was successful, that because our economy, our market didn't melt down because of what the Fed did, that doesn't mean that the Fed did the right thing. I think what the Fed did is going to come back to haunt us. I think we still haven't suffered the full consequences of the reckless decisions made by the Fed, and I think the ECB would be ill-advised to follow in those footsteps. What the ECB should really be doing is holding the politicians in Europe's feet to the fire. If they want a real resolution to the sovereign debt crisis, they need real government spending cuts in those member nations. That would appease the bond market in a positive way. Instead of just buying the bonds that nobody wants, how about making the bonds attractive to investors? You do that by shoring up the solvency of the member nations, by forcing the politicians to act responsibly. The problem is when you print, you bail them out. You let them refuse to be responsible. That's what the Federal Reserve did. Our politicians in America got an easy way out. We didn't have to make any real cuts. We didn't have to, because the Fed was there to bail us out with a printing press. I think there are forces in Europe that recognize that that is the wrong thing to do. And so far, those forces are winning out, and we still have a crisis. Now, I still think the crisis is going to be resolved in the short run, one way or the other. Now, it might be that the ECB bows to pressure and ends up monetizing this debt, buying the Italian or the French bonds or whatever, and we get a short-term resolution. The markets will probably rally if that happens. The euro is going to rally, at least against the dollar. It's probably going to fall off against most other currencies. I think in that environment, gold is really going to take off. But in the long run, that's the wrong thing for Europe to do. I think it would be better to swallow the bitter tasting medicine now. That might actually be slightly negative for the euro in the short run, but I think very, very positive for the euro in the long run. Although, who knows, the euro might even rally right away if that kind of fiscal responsibility was forced upon its member nations. But ultimately, if it succumbs to the pressure to monetize, it's not going to monetize its way out of a crisis. It will be monetizing its way into a much deeper future crisis, because if you let the politicians off the hook, they won't make the necessary cuts, just like American politicians. Which brings me to my next topic for this blog, which is the super committee deadline, which is fast approaching. If you remember back in August, when our politicians decided, unfortunately, to raise the debt ceiling, part of the charade was that there was going to be a lot of cuts that were going to kick in, but they couldn't even identify the cuts. So they created this super committee, and they said that by midnight Wednesday, the day before Thanksgiving, if the super committee doesn't come up with cuts, there's going to be an automatic $1.2 billion in cuts. Now, first of all, the only reason they set up the committee is the same reason Congress always sets up committees, because they didn't want to actually do anything. So rather than cutting government spending, they set up some commission, and they'll let the commission or the committee decide to make the spending, and they don't have to make the tough choices themselves. And then, of course, when the committee finally comes up with recommendations, they usually get ignored, and I think this is going to be the case this time. So far, here it is, almost 3 months later, And just like, you know, high school kids waiting until the last minute to do their term paper, you know, we've known we've had to do this for months. Why it's waiting till the last minute is, you know, reckless and irresponsible. But what do you expect out of Washington? But it will be another charade. But the whole thing is they have to cut $1.2 trillion. The cuts don't even start, even if the automatic cuts go into effect. They don't even start till 2013. So does anybody believe that the cuts are actually going to take place, even if they're agreed on? Because Congress has until 2013 to undo it. Congress can always undo the automatic cuts, which I'm sure they'll do. In fact, who knows? Maybe they'll even undo the cuts before they're enacted. Maybe Congress will agree next week to scrap the automatic spending cuts, just so they don't even create the illusion that they've actually cut spending. Even though they can do that, knowing full well that they have a long time to actually go out and reverse these so-called cuts. And again, these cuts are going to take place over 10 years. So they don't even start until 2013. And then they're spread out over 10 years, which is just over $100 billion a year. And even that, the cuts are skewed to the out years. As small as they are, they don't even start until the outer years. And then again, they're not even cuts. What are they? They're reductions in the proposed rate of increase. So they're not even spending cuts. This whole thing is a farce. And yet here we are living through it again. And one of the biggest farces of the whole thing is that they're not even counting how much interest rates are likely to rise over that period. And all these deficit numbers are going to go out the window when interest rates spike. And that is ultimately what is going to happen. And I think it's going to start. The big increase in U.S. interest rates is going to start when we get some kind of short-term resolution to the European crisis. And I think, contrary to what a lot of American politicians claim, the problems in Europe are not hurting the U.S. economy. They're actually helping this phony U.S. economy sustain itself. Because so many people are worried about the euro, they're buying the dollar. They're buying treasuries because they don't want European bonds. And so the dollar is being perceived as a safe haven, even though there's no safety in the dollar at all. Yet we are benefiting. Consumer prices are lower than they otherwise would be because of the problems in Europe. Interest rates in America are lower than they otherwise would be were it not for the problems in Europe. So when Europe comes to some type of resolution, right or wrong, and I don't think even if they do some of the right things, it's probably not a long-term fix, but it might be a short-term fix, that's going to put a lot of pressure on the U.S. economy, on consumer prices and interest rates. And in fact, even if you look at what some consumer prices are doing right now, take a look at oil. The price of oil went over $100 a barrel this week. It actually got above $103 on Thursday before reversing. I think it closed out today at about $97.50, so below $100. But we've had a huge rally. Remember, oil prices dipped below $75 a barrel in early last month, in early October. And a lot of the recent strength in crude has come despite weakness in the stock market and relative strength in the dollar. So if crude oil can rise even as the dollar is firm and stocks are weak, imagine how much stronger oil prices are going to be when the dollar is weakening and global stock markets are rising, which would happen if we got a short-term resolution to the European crisis. And of course, if the dollar really started to come under pressure, then I think you would start to see a lot more concerns. People would start fleeing the dollar instead of fleeing to the dollar. And you know, one more example of inflation, I figured I'd throw it out there because I just found out about it today. But again, you keep getting all these anecdotal evidence that refute the government's claim that there's no inflation. I got a bill from an attorney, and we have a lot of attorneys that I work with, and the most recent one was letting me know that he increased his rate yet again, his hourly rate. And I went back and I looked at, when I first started dealing with this particular attorney 3 years ago, what he was charging per hour and what he's charging now. And he's now charging 24% more per hour for the same exact services he was providing 3 years ago. So his fees have increased an average of 8% per year over the past 3 years. And of course, my personal legal bills, they go up a lot more than that, because it's not just the hourly rates that go up, but you have to buy a lot more hours because the government keeps passing more rules and more regulations that require more attorneys to help you figure them out. But rates are up 8% a year. starting, and his start goes back to 2008. So during the Great Recession, all this pressure on the economy, yet even in that environment, legal costs are still rising by 8% a year. Now, I don't know, Ben Bernanke says there's no inflation. Well, maybe he doesn't have a lawyer, but he should. In fact, a lot of people in government, these guys used to be lawyers, so it's probably no sweat off of their brow if legal bills are rising. But maybe if some of the people in Congress actually had to run a business, or some of the people in the Fed, they might actually have a better appreciation for how much inflation is actually driving up the cost of doing business and the cost of living in this country. But I have a feeling that if I'm right on the dollar, pretty soon they're not going to be able to lie about inflation. It's going to be so obvious, because it's going to be so rapid, that even the politicians are going to have to acknowledge that it's here. Only they're probably going to rationalize why it's a good thing. Anyway, have a great weekend, everybody. This is Peter Schiff. I will do another video blog again a lot sooner than this one. I'll promise that. Anyway, take care, everybody. Have a great weekend.